Hello and welcome. This is wonderful. Thank you all for coming to this event, which is sponsored by the Society of Authors. My name is Lucinda Byatt, and as a translator into English, I have to add, I'm delighted and honoured to be your chair this evening. I'd like to thank the Society of Authors for sponsoring this event. And the Society has been serving the interests and campaigning for and protecting the rights of authors of all kinds, including translators, for well over a century. And it's also wonderful to have Daniel Hahn here with us this evening, a chair of the Society and also an outstanding translator, as well as Linda Strachan, president of the Society of Authors in Scotland. So this evening will include a couple of short readings, a performance indeed, just to get us in the spirit of translation, as well as a general conversation with the authors. And I'm sure you'll have lots of questions, and so there'll be plenty of time for that, for those towards the end. Julia Donaldson needs no introduction as one of the UK's most popular children's writers, and indeed a best-selling author worldwide. Do I need to mention the Gruffalo?
No.
Children's Laureate from 2011 to 2013. She campaigns ardently for libraries and literacy. Her novels for older children include, among many others, the Princess Mirabel series, and she has been translated into numerous languages, which we will be talking about. Peter May also needs no introduction to this audience. After a career as a highly successful screenwriter, he became an even more successful writer. The internationally best-selling Lewis Trilogy will soon appear on BBC, and he has written two other well-known series, The Enzo Files and The China Thrillers. Entry Island won the 2014 Deanston Scottish Crime Book of the Year Prize, and he'll be talking about his latest novel, Runaway, at the festival here on Sunday. He was shortlisted for the 2015 Dagger in the Library, awarded by the Crime Writers Association. And something which I'm sure we'll come on to, he is the only Westerner to be an honorary member of the Chinese Crime Writers Association. He lives in France, and his books are widely translated. So please welcome two of our best-selling authors in translation. Now, just by way of introduction, I just wanted to talk very briefly about translation. Translation is everywhere. It's a two-way process, moving from one language, or we could say one medium, to another. If we're interested in intercultural communication, translation is essential. Of course, we humans could decide to speak and write the same language, and that pursuit has a long and noble history. And I feel here honour bound to mention Sir Thomas Urquhart of Cromarty, whose proposal for a universal language predates Esperanto by just over two centuries. However, given that those two enterprises didn't succeed, I and other translators still have a job, which is good. There are a couple of statistics that bear reporting. At Book Expo America this year, the largest publishing trade fair in North America, it became clear that the Chinese publishing market was poised to exceed the US book market in total revenues. The Chinese are avid readers. Secondly, the UN now think that India will overtake China as the world's most populous country by 2022. So literacy rates lag there, but changes are underway. So the translation of English works into foreign languages ranks among our top cultural exports. You need only walk into a bookshop abroad to see the extraordinary number of translated titles. Not all of them, but a lot from English. Just let me mention Italy, where translation has fallen back because of costs, but still represents about 18%, that's 18% of all books sold, with a staggering 60% of those being from the Anglophone world. The current dominance of English in translated works is relatively recent. Walter Scott was the first British author to be widely translated and become an international bestseller. Translations the other way, so into English, are well behind those European levels. And although much has improved, they still hover around that slightly mythical 3% level. That's 3% as, you know, against the Italian, as I mentioned just now, 18. So in that two-way process of translation, events focusing on newly translated foreign authors tend understandably to dominate book festivals here. And tonight is a first for the Edinburgh Book Festival, at least to my knowledge, as we are celebrating best-selling authors translated out of English. To start off the evening, we have a multilingual version of the Gruffalo to perform for you. And I'm on, again, you know, duty-bound to mention the translators. So here goes Jean-François Ménard from French, Monica Osberghaus from German, Arlette Raimondi from Italian, and James Robertson from Scots. And we will now give you a little performance.
Shall we put this?
Yes, so we'll move this a little bit. Move our chairs back.
Move that out of the way. Okay. Whoops. So, I think, have we got everyone in their places? Yes? I think we need the Euler. Is she going to be the... Oh, yes, that's
all
good.
Sorted, okay. I think.
Right, put my ears on. A mouse took a stroll through the deep, dark wood. A fox saw the mouse, and the mouse looked good.
Eh bien, jolie petite souris. Où vas-tu dans ce bois? J'ai un joli terrier. Viens manger avec moi. Oh,
c'est terriblement gentil, mon beau renardeux. Mais je dois déjeuner avec un gruffalo.
Un gruffalo? Mais qu'est-ce que c'est?
Un gruffalo, tout le monde le sait. Ses défenses sont terribles, ses griffes effrayantes, ses dents redoutables, ses mâchoires terrifiantes.
Où vas-tu le retrouver?
Ben ici, derrière ces rochers. Et le renard rôti, c'est son plat préféré.
Renard rôti? Ah non, merci. Adieu, petite souris.
Et très vite, il s'enfuit. Silly old fox, doesn't he know? There's no such thing as a gruffalo. On went the mouse through the deep, dark wood. An owl saw the mouse, and the mouse looked good.
Wohin, kleiner Maus? Komm, mach eine Rast. Ich lad dich zum Tee ein. Auf meinen Ast.
Ein andermal wäre ich darüber sehr froh. Doch jetzt muss ich weiter zum Gruffalo.
Zum Gruffalo? Sag, was ist das für ein Tier?
Den kennst du nicht? Dann beschreibe ich ihn dir. Er hat knotige Knie, eine grässliche Tatze und vorn im Gesicht eine giftige Warze.
Wo trifft ihn denn?
Gleich hier unten, am Fluss. Und er isst gerne Eule mit Zuckerguss.
Gezuckerte Eule! Schuhu, schuhu! Schnell weg!
Rief die Eule, fort war sie im Nu. Silly old owl, doesn't he know? There's no such thing as a gruffalo. On went the mouse through the deep, dark wood. A snake saw the mouse, and the mouse looked good.
Hey, Topo, che
fai nella foresta? Dai, vieni da me e facciamo una festa.
Sei molto gentile, ma dico di no a mi incontro per cena con il Gruffalo.
Il Gruffalo, dici? E chi sarà mai?
Oh, come davvero? Tu non lo sai? Occhi arancioni, la lingua molliccia, ecco le violacce sulla pelliccia.
E dove lo incontri?
Qui in riva al laghetto. Ah, e adora i serpenti cotti al funghetto.
Serpenti al funghetto, ma per dindirindina!
E scivolò via tra l'erba fina. Silly old snake, doesn't he know? There's no such thing as a Gruffalo! Oh! But who is this creature with terrible claws and terrible teeth and his terrible jaws? He has knobbly knees and turned out toes and a poisonous water at the end of his nose. His eyes are orange. His tongue is black. He has purple prickles all over his back. Oh, help! Oh, no! It's a Gruffalo!
My favorite food.
And the Gruffalo smiled.
You taste good. Fried, baked, or boiled.
Good, cried the moose. Dinna cry me good. I'm the most fearsome beastie in this wood. Just walk ahint me, and you'll soon see. Abody is fit for me.
Right you are,
said the Gruffalo, fit to burst.
Ah, walk ahint ye, and ye gang fast.
And we're just leaving it at that. Okay, thank you. Whoops.
There we go. Fantastic. Oh, whoops. Great, so that has sort of warmed us all up nicely. Fantastic. Let's start by talking about titles, if we can. Titles are complicated and sometimes don't translate well and sometimes have to be changed for mysterious reasons. How important is the title and its translation? Peter, would you like to about that?
It's obviously very important in the language into which the book is being translated. Some of my books have ended up with some very strange titles, particularly in French. French, like long titles that are almost as long as the book sometimes. I can think of one particular one which had a nice, smart, one-word title, Snakehead. And I thought, Tête du Serpent, why not? And they said, no, that won't work in French. It never works in French. And it ended up being Cadavre Chinois à Houston. Chinese bodies in Houston. Yes.
Why?
Good question. And actually, just today, I was had an exchange of emails with my French publisher about the title of the fourth Enzo book, which is set in an island in the Bay of Biscay called L'Île de Groix. Mm-hmm. And the book in English is titled Freeze Frame, which they didn't want to translate in that form. So they came up with the idea of calling it L'Île au Rebus. And I said, but don't you know that Ian Rankin's character is called Rebus? And they said, oh no, but that would be L'Île de Rebus. Subtlety is lost on me, I'm afraid, yes.
Fantastic. And likewise, I think Gruffalo, particularly, I mean, not to mention any of the others, but Gruffalo's got a...
Yeah, but just quickly to mention one of the others, because you mentioned French. I've got a book called The Giants and the Joneses, so that was going to be difficult in French. But it's in French, I quite like the title in French, it's Trois Enfants chez les Géants, which sound, all French films seem to be called things like Mon cousin en Amérique, or something. You know, there was a sort of relation and a play. But in English, three children in giant land, it just wouldn't work.
So,
sometimes it's all for the best.
Yeah.
So the Gruffalo, I think I've got a few slides. Has B got the someone?
Oh
doing
yeah,
the,
oh, that, this
okay,
is
so
good,
I won't talk about all the all the different titles. For a start,
how many have we got two on the Gruffalo?
Well, I think it's supposed to add up to 65. Oh, so those are all the languages it's in. So on the whole, I think I've got some examples. On the whole, he is just El Gruffalo or Der Gruffalo. He's got an umlaut there. Very good. But sometimes a bit different. I think that's Irish. I've been told the Irish version's much better than the original. It's by a poet. It's by a very good poet. South African, Die Gurgumka. It still begins with G. Anymore? Finnish, I don't know why that's Merkili. I'm not sure if I pronounced it right. I can't even pronounce that one. I'm not quite sure what that one is. Or that one. I think that is that Russian? Okay. But that's interesting. That's a Hebrew one. Again, I can't really read the title. But if you notice, obviously the book is from our point of view back to front. But not just the writing. The mouse is actually walking in a different direction through the book. He's walking just in our books, usually in an illustrated book, the character's walking from left to right. The mouse is walking from left to right. But in the Hebrew and the Arabic version, he's walking in the other direction. So that's just a few of them. I don't really know what the titles. Oh, I know also. In the Maori one, because I was in New Zealand recently, and he's called something like Tangua, I can't remember what it is, but I found out they only have very few consonants.
Okay.
So he couldn't be called a Gruffalo because they don't have R, G, or half the consonants that we have.
I think very occasionally it works the other way around, that the title is sometimes better in the translated language.
I was going to say.
The Black House, which was my breakthrough book, a nice succinct title, when it was published in France, they didn't like that. It said it won't work, La Maison Noire, it's just not going to work. And they called it L'Île des Chasseurs d'Oiseaux, which is the island of the bird hunters, which I actually rather liked. But it was too late to change it in the English. But I found actually most of the other European countries have adopted that title in translation.
The Italian certainly has taken on that one, which is great. Exactly. Yeah. Peter, perhaps you'd like to tell us, in fact, about, just we mentioned the Black House, the story, as it were, because it is rather remarkable, that idea that the book, in a way, launched in France, and was accepted by French publishers.
It's one of those stories that you come across in publishing from time to time where a book, which I believed at the time when I'd written it was the best thing I'd ever written, got rejected by every publisher in Britain. And which is kind of heartbreaking, and you lose confidence because if you believe a book is that good, how come all these publishers didn't want to publish it? So I went on to do other things, and it lay in a drawer for 3 years. And I was at a book fair in Brive in southwest France, and my publisher was there, and I had a chance conversation with her in which I explained I had this manuscript in a drawer which I thought was the best thing I'd ever written, but nobody wanted to publish. And she said, well, let me read it. So I sent it to her. She called me up about 6 weeks later and said, I love it. I want to buy world rights. And I mean, French publishers just don't buy world rights in books written in English. So it was kind of unique that way. They had it translated. It was published in France, became a big success. They then sold it because they had the rights all over Europe, and finally to the Brits.
Finally
to the Brits. And the irony is that in the UK is where it's become the
really
biggest success of all. Yeah,
isn't that extraordinary? So that was a reverse kind of import back again. Fantastic. Do you think it matters? This is probably addressed sort of to both of you in a way, but do you think it matters whether the readers know in what language a story originates? Does it matter that, for example, the Gruffalo starts in English and then goes into all these other languages, or the Black House or the other Lewis books?
I suppose if you're reading Anna Karenina or something, the Russian books.
I think the setting determines that very much. I mean, a French person is unlikely to write a book set in the Hebrides. The setting is going to determine very much how the reader views the book, and obviously they're going to see it as being something in translation. But if it's well translated, I don't think it makes any difference.
Except I think that that's interesting about the setting, because the reader brings so much to a book. If you know the setting, you know, like if you... grown up in London when it was foggy and you read a Dickens novel, the author doesn't have to do very much to describe it. Whereas I think I always feel sorry for travel writers, because they can't just say two words and everyone
knows.
Oh yes, I know that. You know, and so travel writers have to really describe things properly. So I think that must affect, surely some books might be really good in the original language, but when they're translated, because the author hasn't perhaps bothered to describe the place very much.
Or the cultural references are very often, I think, more important than the linguistic ones, because there are so many things, particularly if you're writing about a fairly arcane place somewhere that people don't know a lot about, and in which there are very strong cultural references, then that is very, very difficult, I think, for the translator, because the translator themselves don't necessarily make those connections.
Absolutely.
And so it's very hard for them then to for the reader to be connected with them.
Yeah. Let's, in fact, talk about your translators a moment. So do they get in touch? I'm always interested in this question as a translator. Do the translators get in touch with you? Or
I'm very glad to say I don't.
With all those
languages. 65, don't, otherwise I wouldn't have a free. But no, I don't know, but I do tend to get sent sometimes the French and German ones to cast an eye over, but I hate that actually because they're, we'll probably come on to this later, because they're rhyming texts.
Yeah.
And it's terribly difficult by email to, without terribly hurting their, I think I terribly hurt this French man's feelings once by trying to email him about scansion. And the French is so different as well, because the French way of scanning it things is just a syllable count, and the English scansion is more a musical
metric
thing.
Yeah.
So I don't know, do they get in touch with you?
Not very many, no.
No.
I think, well, I know both of my French translators quite well. My Italian translator has been in touch, and Portuguese and the Czech. And I don't think any of the others have been in touch. But it's interesting because, you know, I have two translators in France. One did the series of books set in China, because she spoke Chinese and knew China, so it made sense for her to translate those books. But it's interesting because, you know, I can read the text that she's translated and I can't see my style of writing in it. I can read in French. I don't read for pleasure in French, but I can. And I don't see my style in it. It's a very French style that she translates it into. She's very faithful. My other translator, who did the all the Lewis books, very much picked up on my style, which is very non-French, but it has gone down incredibly well with French readers. I mean, short, sharp sentences, as opposed to the long, kind of convoluted French flowery kind of construction. That
reminds me, actually, I must tell you about this. Talking about French flowery sentences, because one of my books, The Snail and the Whale, in English it's, this is a tale of a tiny snail and a great big grey-blue humpback whale. In French, it's, à quoi pense ce petit escargot perché sur les gros roches, sur les gros roches noirs? What is the little snail thinking about perched on this big black rock? Pourquoi regarde-t-il si tristement les bateaux qui s'éloignent? Why is he looking so sadly at the boats which are going into the distance? Chaque jour, il soupire, every day, he is sighing. It's kind of like very French,
yeah,
isn't
very
it?
Yes. Beautiful, fantastic. Okay. So I wonder, I mean, about the Lewis books in particular, do you think the translator, that one, the one you were talking about just now, travelled up to Lewis?
No.
No?
He's never been, no.
Oh, really?
But I get screeds of notes from him and questions, lots and lots of questions. As he's become more familiar with the place and the culture,
and
the
says,
questions have been
and
reduced.
That? Yeah. Well,
but I mean, even down to like, what are sixth year studies? I mean, that's not a particularly Lewis thing, but it's a Scottish thing.
And it's
what are sixth year studies? And he wanted to find a literal translation. I said, there is no literal translation. Mm. Just call it the back.
Yeah.
You know. But yes, he's full of questions.
He's full of
and
questions.
So is my, actually, the other translator, is she's doing the Enzo books at the moment. And one of those, it's very interesting because the clues are entirely dependent on English wordplay, which absolutely does not work in French.
Oh, yeah.
And so she's had a mammoth job. She's almost had to rewrite that whole kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, so we've had a lot of to-ing and fro-ing on that, and she's been trying out stuff with me. Does this work? Does that work? And I think ultimately she did a terrific job.
So can you think of an example of a book wordplay in
Well, I can't, but I can't because there might be people here who haven't read the book, and I don't want to
give it away. Well, it's a good moment anyway to hear some of your work. But what we're going to do is we're going to hear a little bit of the latest Italian translation. And this is the third book, isn't it? The Chessman.
Yes.
Yeah, the third book in the trilogy. And we're going to hear the read by Giorgio Granozio. And he's going to read the translation by Chiara Uica, which is an unusual name, but anyway. And she has translated this book, and it's entitled L'Uomo degli Scacchi, which is interesting because that's l'uomo, you know, singular, as opposed to chess men.
Yes, yes.
Another of these titles thing. Now, you may all have an English copy of this, so just so you can follow along. And Giorgio Granozzo is going to read a very short introduction.
L'uomo siede alla scrivania, pallido per la paura e il peso del passo estremo che, una volta intrapreso, sarà senza ritorno, come il tempo e la morte. Mentre scrive, nella sua mano la penna trema. Ecco ciò a cui penso da un po' di tempo. So che la maggior parte della gente non capirà il perché, specialmente quelli che mi vogliono bene e ai quali io voglio bene a mia volta. Tutto quel che posso dire è che nessuno conosce l'inferno che ho attraversato e che in queste ultime settimane è diventato semplicemente insopportabile. È ora che io vada. Mi dispiace proprio tanto. L'uomo appone la sua firma. Il solito pomposo scarabocchio, illeggibile. Quindi piega il biglietto, quasi che coprire le parole potesse farle scomparire, come un incubo. Come il passo che sta per compiere, nell'oscurità. Poi si alza e si guarda attorno nella sua stanza per l'ultima volta, chiedendosi se davvero avrà il coraggio di portare a termine quel che ha iniziato. È giusto lasciare il biglietto oppure no? Farebbe davvero qualche differenza? Lo guarda. Ora è aperto e appoggiato allo schermo del computer, dove spera che sarà impossibile non vederlo. Il dolore del rimorso gli riempie il cuore, mentre il suo sguardo segue le lettere tondeggianti che ha imparato a scrivere tanti anni fa, quando aveva ancora tutta la vita davanti. Un ricordo agrodolce di innocenza e giovinezza. L'odore della polvere di gesso e del latte caldo della scuola. Come si è rivelato tutto inutile. Quando Fina aprì gli occhi, l'interno del vecchio rifugio in pietra che aveva dato loro riparo dalla tempesta era soffuso da una strana luce rosata. Salendo dal fuoco ormai quasi spento, del fumo vagava pigro nell'aria immobile. Whistler se n'era andato. Si sollevò sui gomiti e notò che la pietra che chiudeva l'accesso al rifugio era stata spostata. Al di là riusciva a vedere la foschia dell'alba tinta di rosa che faceva da cappello alle montagne. La tempesta era passata, aveva scaricato la sua pioggia e lasciato dietro di sé un silenzio innaturale. Dolorosamente sgusciò fuori dalle lenzuola e strisciò oltre il caminetto fino ai suoi vestiti, sparsi ovunque sulla pietra. Erano ancora un po' umidi, ma abbastanza asciutti per essere indossati di nuovo. Finn si stese supino e contorcendosi entrò nei pantaloni, poi si sedette per abbottonarsi la camicia e infilarsi il maglione dalla testa. Si mise i calzini e spinse i piedi negli stivali e subito uscì a gattoni sul pendio della montagna senza preoccuparsi di allacciarli. Il panorama che lo accolse pareva provenire da un altro mondo. Le montagne della parte sud-ovest di Lewis si ergevano ripide tutto attorno, scomparendo nell'oscurità di nubi basse. La valle sottostante appariva più ampia di quanto era sembrata alla luce dei lampi durante la notte. Gli enormi frammenti di roccia disseminati sul terreno crescevano come spettri fuori da una nebbia che giungeva ad avvolgere il paesaggio da est, dove il sole, non ancora visibile, gettava il suo bagliore di un rosso innaturale. Pareva di essere all'alba dei tempi.
Thank you. Did I really write that?
I don't, you did. I
wow.
There you go. yeah, so that's quite nice. That was just, I mean, I think it's just recently come out in Italian, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. What about names? I mean, just sticking with Finn for a moment. Finn is called Finn MacLeod. And Finn MacLeod... there's another MacLeod in your writing.
Enzo MacLeod.
And I gather this has caused problems, is that right?
Well, not really. Only for the Germans.
Only for the Germans, okay.
because The Black House was written and Finn MacLeod was the character and it was sitting in a drawer for 3 years, I'd started writing this other series in which I'd called my main character Enzo MacLeod, never thinking that Finn was going to see the light of day. And so... it never caused anybody any problems when both lots of books were suddenly on the shelves, except the Germans said, our readers will get confused. Are they related? And I'm going, no. Well, is everybody in Scotland called MacLeod? And I thought, well, almost, because I can remember sitting in the departure hall at Stornoway Airport. Hall is a kind of grand word for it. Hut is more like it. And the announcer came over the tannoy and said, would Mr. MacLeod please come to the information desk? And half the airport stood up, you know. But the Germans couldn't deal with two characters called MacLeod, so they insisted that Enzo had to have a different surname, so he's now MacLean.
Oh, he's MacLean, okay.
Yeah. Or Mackay.
Mackay.
Is it Mackay? One of those, yes.
Anyway, yeah. So just to confuse things. Moving on, Julia, I just wondered, there's another interesting idea about translation. This is getting quite theoretical. when you translate, sometimes it's nice to make foreign ideas more domestic to the reader. It's called domestication. And so therefore, when, for example, you have in the Gruffalo, I think this was something that might have come up, you know, you have particular ideas and metaphors, you know, that are very English, shall we say. Did that ever cause any problems?
Well, I don't know about problems, well, really, but know. just then that bit of the Gruffalo that we did.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, in English, the mouse says that, tells the fox that the Gruffalo's favourite food is roasted fox, and the owl, it's owl ice cream, and you know, and so on. Yeah. In the original French translation, this is a different bit actually. The Gruffalo then says that his favourite food is mouse on a slice of bread. But in the original French version, it was mouse on a bed of artichokes. Yeah, I need artichokes. So, exactly.
Things like that. I think those are the kind of the amusing bits of translation, but I think you had to sort of possibly come back, rein back, did you? And it went back to toast in the end or not? No.
I think if artichokes had rhymed with said, I might have had a bed of artichokes, actually, yes.
I know, so those are the problems, anyway. Brilliant, you've led into that nicely. So rhyming. Rhyming is obviously a problem. I mean, we've had Peter talking about plays on words, impossible in a translation, or at least very, very hard. Rhyming too?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people do get told just don't write in rhyme because it's difficult to translate. Sometimes that's just an excuse for rejecting a book, actually. But obviously it's very difficult. I feel very sorry for the translators, actually, because, for instance, when I wrote my first book, A Squash and a Squeeze, which was a song, and there's lots of rhymes for squeeze, so there's I'm down on my knees, help me please, and so on. And one of the rhymes is sneeze. My nose has a tickle, there's no room to sneeze. But it wasn't my favourite line in the book. So in the German translation, you know, the poor translator, of course, squash and a squeeze, you know, oh, I know, mein Haus ist too eng und zu klein, my house is too small and too narrow. So klein, narrow, small, isn't going to rhyme with sneeze or any of these things, you know. But they felt they had to keep the sneezing in. So the old woman still says, I've got a terrible sneeze and something or other else that rhymes with klein, very, very difficult, I think.
Exactly.
Yeah, but I must say, a lot of the translators are really good poets. They and I met the Swedish one. He's about 90 and wearing an orange linen suit at the Bologna Book Fair. And there are lots of very distinguished people out there doing translating.
Fantastic. Excellent. Now, something a bit more serious. Copyright. This is something which, you know, translators and authors have to fight for. We're all fighting our corner, I think. But in the translation, a translation is a separate creative work. And it has had that status since, I think it's 1886 or something, you know, a long time, the Berne Convention, which most countries are signed up to. The problem, though, is getting publishers to recognise that. There are a few translators, well, you have to be quite good to translate to retain your copyright, you can assert your moral rights. Do you think, I mean, when you're with translators, do you, you know, make sure that they're named, or does this not arise, actually? Possibly not, I don't know.
Well, I think it's very important that translators are credited. Mm-hmm. The first translator I ever worked with, who Ariane Bataille, my first French translator, negotiated a contract with the publisher where she actually took a share of the royalties. Mm-hmm. And I think that is absolutely the right way to do it. Yes, there should be an upfront payment for the work, but a share of the royalties, it seems to me, is only fair that the translator should share in the success of the book if it's successful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know how that happens when a book's out of copyright. If someone does a new translation of War and Peace, say, do they then get royalties? I don't know how that works.
70 years, so, you know, that it depends is the answer.
Yeah, I know. So, yeah. I mean, that is, for something that's definitely out of copyright, from the
if it's
the
a new translation, so even if it's in copyright, the translation, as long as she's got the rights or he's got the rights to translate it, will still be a separate work.
Yeah, so would they get all the money? Copyright. Say there was a wonderful new translation of War and Peace, presumably Tolstoy's War and Peace.
I don't know what Tolstoy's estate's like, but it depends on the literary estate, essentially, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, but would the translator, say the literary estate, say, yeah, it's well after 70 years and no money is going to go to the original author because they've been dead a long time, then will the translator,
as long as the publisher and the contract, get all the money? And this is where the translator will send their contract to the Society of Authors, get it vetted. The answer is yes, I think, yes. As long as there is not any literary estate that will then claim some sort of royalty as well. Promoting books abroad, how is it? I mean, you know, best-selling authors, and there you are promoting books abroad. How is it? I mean, what's it? Is it easier? Is it the same as in this country? What sort of things happens, as it were?
Malcolm and I have done several German tours, and because the illustrator of the Gruffalo and a lot of the other books is German, and so we've done 5 German tours, and acting the stories out in German, and it's great. Actually, the children really, really. But they got much more patience, I think, than the English. They got much better concentration, and they'll sit for longer, and they'll stamp and cheer and clap. And we've been to Italy and France
done the
as
same
well.
Thing. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I live in France, of course, so I do a lot of promotion around France, and it's very different. I mean, the very first time that I was published there, and I had lunch with my publisher before I was going to do my first events, and she said, "So, have you been brushing up on your French?" And I said, "You mean I have to speak French?" She said, "Of course." I said, "But my French is terrible." And she said, "Oh, don't worry, they'll think you're cute." And I wasn't sure I wanted to be seen as cute. You know? So I've had to work hard to bring my French up to standard because, you know, France is very, very different from the UK, where literally every small town, almost village, has its own book fair. Mm. And you get invites to all of these all the time. You can't possibly do them all. And there are enormous book fairs. My local one is the second biggest in France, and you get a quarter of a million people over the course of a weekend. Mm. Huge. But you also have your events in bookstores, and in France there are so many. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of bookstores in France, independent bookstores. They don't have the big chains like we have here or in the States. And in Paris, for example, there are they say there are 800 a bookstore for every 800 people in Paris.
Wow.
That's a lot of bookstores.
Well, it's probably because they still have the what's it called? You know,
the net book agreement.
Yeah.
Which yes, because books are so much more expensive in France.
Yeah.
I mean, a book, any of my books coming out now in French, the hardback, or they call it grand format, would probably be about €22.
Yeah.
Here nowadays, they're all discounted right down to the bone, and you're probably only paying £8 or £9 for that.
Yeah. And even Amazon, Amazon.fr, they have to still have those prices.
Yes,
don't they?
That's right. Yeah. They're still bound by that.
Mm-mm-mm. Exactly. Oh well, that's interesting. Thinking of, you know, that's that you abroad, as it were, so that cultural export. But the cultural export can have another side to it, which is that it brings people back to Scotland. And we mentioned Walter Scott just before when I was talking earlier. And his works, you know, undoubtedly resulted in a growth in tourism in Scotland in, you know, that time in the 19th century. So literary tourism is something which I think is a really interesting parallel to this best-selling author abroad, but bringing tourists back here. So Lewis particularly, presumably, must be way, you know, isn't it?
I mean, tourism has absolutely skyrocketed in the Hebrides. There's now a Peter May literary trail.
Like
and you can go and visit all the spots that occur in the books, and they have maps, and there's a website, and accommodation and restaurants where to eat. And people, the French, when I travel around France, I mean, everywhere I go, people say, "You've given me the desire to go and visit the Hebrides," and many of them have. It's fantastic, actually.
That's funny, actually, because there's Gruffalo trails in about 100 different places.
Yes.
But I'm not sure where the Gruffalo actually lives.
Yes. But I wonder if it brings in foreigners. It probably is just attracting, you know, all your dedicated, devoted fans here, I guess. As well.
I'm hoping that when these four Scots, because there is a Scots Gruffalo, but there's going to be a Doric one.
I think we have it, the Doric Gruffalo.
Oh, is that the Doric
right
one?
Here.
Right. I think.
Gallic?
There's already been Gallic for ages, but there's going to be.
Orcadian.
Maybe I might be rivaling you, there might be a Lewis. There's definitely a Hebridean.
Yeah.
There's definitely a Shetland. Oh, yes. Oh, no. There's definitely a Shetland one.
Yeah.
I think. Dundee, I think that's where he really lives, yes.
Dundonian.
There is a Dundonian one coming.
Dundonian
out,
will be amazing. Yeah. Well, there you go. Yeah. Anyway, well, I think we need to throw open the floor to you, as it were, and see if there are any questions. So, we've got one right there. Now, we've got a roving mic, so keep your hand up. And the mic, this gentleman here with the tie.
Madam Chair, how delightful in Edinburgh, this cosmopolitan city, to hear the beautiful Italian language, to hear references to German and French. This is Edinburgh at its best, if I may say so. We've just come from Hancock's half hour, going back to the old radio stations, and this has been wonderful. My question is this. Having grown up with the French for a long time, translation isn't just Julia Donaldson rhyming. Because, for example, if you're doing the Selkirk grace, some hay meat and canny eat. The French don't understand this. You have to translate it to bread, because being without meat doesn't mean anything to the French. It has to be bread. So it's not just a question of rhyming. My question is the following. If you have the question, Monsieur les Anglais, tirez les premiers, is this showing English fair play, where the French are suggesting, after you, Claude, or is it, here come the English, shoot as quick as you can? How would you translate it?
Oh,
having come from Gaillac and the wines of Clément de Termes, in your to Germany, how would you translate it? Are the French being aggressive, or are the French being friendly?
Tell me again.
Monsieur les Anglais, tirez les premiers, meaning after you. You have first shot, les Anglais. Or they're saying, here come the English.
Is there a subtext?
My troops, the French, you shoot first.
Yeah. Well, it's probably the latter. Being a Scot in France helps sometimes, quite a lot actually. I don't know. Actually, I think this whole question of rivalry between English, British, French is a bit of a myth. And most French that I know have great warmth towards everybody from these islands. My guess is it's a joke.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, no. There, sorry, behind you. Yeah, thank you.
Hello, we saw on the slides, I think we saw about 8 or 9 slides, I think there was only one on which we saw the translator's name. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered what all three of you thought about the the translator's name appearing on the cover of the book.
This is actually a very serious question, because again, name the translator. This is actually a Twitter hashtag, and naming the translator on the cover, absolutely, but actually even in book reviews, all these other things, often the translator gets left out. Mm. So should the name of the translator be on your covers? What do you think about that?
I think it's difficult. Yeah. It's difficult in an illustrated book, I think, because it's such a designy thing to just put too much. It should obviously be on the title page.
Inside cover. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You have already the author plus illustrator on the outside cover, I think, don't you? Always.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yeah. And then translator, not always.
I would have no problem with that. I think I think it's very important. I think because translation is not just about word for word. It's not about being literal. It's I think the art of the translator is also the same art as that of a writer, and that it's taking a text and it's conveying the spirit of that text, not necessarily the letter of that text. So there's an enormous creative input to that, and I do feel that the translator should get a credit. And I know that when you read reviews in French newspapers and magazines, they always say, traduit de l'anglais par...
I was wrong, because this is Whit the Clock Lady Hurl. This is the latest Scots version of what the ladybird heard.
Yeah.
I think, I must say, Clock Lady
beats
ladybird. And that says... In fact, his name's bigger than ours. It says, by the author of the graphic, by Julia Donaldson, illustrated by Lydia Monks, translated into Scots by James Robertson. Yeah. I think they mostly are, actually.
I think it is surprising how names get left out still, even in major newspapers.
I think that's shocking.
Occasionally, I have to say, you get translations, not obviously of a long novel, but... If it's a picture book, sometimes it's just the publisher. If it's they've just done it on the back of an envelope, and it's a bit, and they don't even want to. They don't, they have no pride in it, and so they can't always. Sometimes there's no one really to acknowledge.
Mm. Well, there we go. Anyway, another question. Yes, please, there. Can you keep your hand up? And the mic will come around to you.
It's a question for Peter. And reading the Lewis books in English, there's, you know, clearly quite a lot of the Gaelic language comes through in a sense, even just trying to explain to people how to pronounce the names, which I struggled with. I'm interested in what you have to say about how Gaelic is part of the Lewis culture, but the books in English, or how you approach that.
Well, I think my experience, I lived up there for 5-6 years when I was producing Macha, and my experience was very much that Gaelic and English cohabited within the culture. And that while we were doing a television series, a drama which was in the Gaelic language, nobody spoke only Gaelic. Everybody spoke English and Gaelic. So it's very much a bilingual culture. And I think to write about the islands without including that very powerful Gaelic element, not just to the language, but to the culture and the history, would be wrong. And so, I've always felt that flavour of history, culture, and language should be there in the books.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else like to ask a question? Sorry, yeah, thank you.
Hi, what you've been saying has been interesting me a great deal. I learnt languages at university and I'm keen to hear your thoughts on, you've talked about translating books from one language into the other, but what about books that are run parallel? So you have a page of the in a foreign language and then a page in English, and from what you've been saying about interpretation playing a role in then what the book reads like in a new language, I'm keen to understand how you might think or what role you might think those kinds of books play in helping people to learn a new language or using their favourite books to learn new words if perhaps the translation isn't quite so as straightforward as we thought it might be.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Can you just slightly recap?
Yes, it's really the use of translating as a teaching tool. Is that what I understood? I mean, in the sense of having parallel translation. Mm. So having the original text and then the other text. Which I don't know if it really applies to your two books, but it's an interesting concept.
Not necessarily, but I did a book for a French publisher. It was a novella. It was only about 190 or 100 pages long. And it was part of a series of books called Paper Planes, and it was to help French students of English learn the language. Mm. And the brief in writing the story, it was actually based on the characters from the China series. And the brief was to use vocabulary that had French or Latin roots that French readers would find more easy to understand. So we were getting away from the Germanic or Scandinavian roots of the English words. So it was written in English, but written the secret was to try and make it not obvious. But, you know, instead of a body, you would talk about a cadaver. I think, you know, that use of language in fiction is quite a useful tool in terms of learning a language.
Absolutely. I would agree, definitely. I mean, I think parallel texts can be extremely useful for that learning process. Absolutely. Yeah. Any other questions just before we're going to close? One more here. Thank you.
Hi, it's a question for Julia. You mentioned earlier about getting published as a rhyming children's author. I know that you said that normally if they say, no, we don't do that, it's usually just a way to get you out their house. But I just wondered, not all of them, obviously, but I just wondered, how did you get the Gruffalo first published if rhyming's not really something that they want to get into because of the translation rights and things?
I'm sorry, I'm still, because I've got hearing aids and you're talking to a microphone, I'm not picking up every word, so if you could...
I'll paraphrase just quickly. Yeah. It was really about the rhyming problem again, that you had said that sometimes rhyming can put publishers off because it's a way of, it's difficult to do, and therefore, how did it... How did the Gruffalo first
I think it does, but then, the Gruffalo mostly... As far, I don't obviously speak all this language, the ones I do speak, they mostly do rhyme. But of course, some different languages don't have rhyme in the sense that we do. They don't have rhyme word endings. As I said before, I think it does put publishers off. Mm. It can put publishers off. But if they like a text enough, they'll still go for it. And I do think that, sometimes people just say, oh, it's, if they don't terribly like it and it's in rhyme, they just use that as an excuse, really, probably.
So I'm going to ask a question. Chair's privilege. I must ask Peter just about the Chinese Crime Writers Association, honorary member of. But are you still the only one?
As far as I know, yes. Yeah.
Because it must be a wonderful selling point, I should think, in China.
In China.
Yeah, having given you those statistics about Chinese book publishing,
Yeah, I was first published in China about 10, 12 years ago.
Yeah.
It's a long story how I got there, so there's probably not enough time for that. But I was sitting next to, at the dinner where I was presented this award and made the honorary member, I was sitting beside this Chinese crime writer who told me that he had just sold something like 5 million copies of his book in one province. And I said, wow, you must have made a fortune. He said, no, not a penny. They don't pay me royalty. They pay me, like 10 quid to write the thing, and then that's it. It's interesting because the Chinese don't have the concept of copyright in the way that we do.
Well, we know
And it's a minefield. Yeah, it really is.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. Well, we didn't get onto that, but that would have been good. But never mind. Another time, we'll do this again. Anyway, well, I'm afraid we've come to the end. And please, all I can say is let's thank our readers, our performers, and of course our two authors for a fantastic evening. Thank you.